Thank you very much, Lucia. It's a pleasure for me to welcome all of you, also on behalf of the Department of Mathematics, and in particular of the Laboratory for the Communication of Science. I see many of my team scattered around here. And my talk will be a very introductory one. So I apologize with the colleagues if they will not see particularly technical things, but just to give you some flavor, some idea of such a huge amount of wonderful megalithic monuments we have in Europe, and a bit of flavor of the way archaeoastronomy, and more generally I would say the archaeology of landscape, including the sky, that I prefer this kind of definition, can help us in understanding this kind of complex silent monuments. So, first of all, I will make an overview of a few of these monuments, but I cannot but start from this place. This place is the place where megalithic architecture was actually born. Because we must remember that up to a few tens of years or other years ago, everyone was convinced that the start of architecture was after the Neolithic Revolution. So the idea was that the people first invented agriculture, then started to make stable settlements, and architecture came as a result, so let's say in the fifth millennium BC. Today we do know that this is completely false, because the megalithic architecture starts here in Göbekli Tepe, and it is very well dated to before the seventh millennium BC, so before the Neolithic Revolution, the introduction of agriculture. It is even possible that places like this started as pilgrimage centers, and the needs for the construction of such sacred centers triggered the introduction of agriculture even. So let's have a look to Göbekli Tepe. Maybe you have, I think you have seen it. Anyway, there is a hill which is covered by these huge oval enclosures. Each one contains several T-shaped megaliths, and these megaliths usually bring engravings or even statues. And these engravings are mostly of animals, like this, but they contain also more complex scenes which are very difficult to interpret. What is astonishing is that this place was backfilled, was completely, was abandoned and covered. So we can have a very precise dating limit, which is about the 8 millennium, half of the 8 millennium BC. So we are much before the introduction of agriculture. This is the start of megalithic art. It probably it is not only Göbekli Tepe, there are many other sites in the area which await to be excavated. Well, this was in a sense necessary, because otherwise we come back to the idea that the architecture was generated by permanent sentiment, which is an idea which we must rethink in a sense. We are still rethinking, of course, but we must rethink. Anyway, now we go to the around the 5th millennium BC, and we see an explosion of megalithic architecture. Of course, I cannot show you such thousands of places, so I just picked up a few places. Most of them are very well known, a few others are less known, just to give you a flavor, an idea of such wonderful monuments. And for the aims of presentation, I've divided in two periods, so up to the say the start of Stone Age to the 3000 BC, and later up to the beginning of the Bronze Age. So let's have a look to a few of these places. The first one is traditionally mentioned as the Kerkado tumulus in Karnak. Karnak is in Brittany, and this is relatively well dated to the 5th millennium BC, 5,000 years BC. It is a tumulus, so it's a dromos of megalithic slabs covered by a Herten mound. Of course, Karnak is not only graves like Kerkado, it is a set of many complex monuments. This is the hugest stone which, as far as we know, was ever quarried and erected in Europe. It is the so-called Grand Menhir. It's a menhir, but it's some 20 meters. It was some 20 meters high and some 200 tons, more or less. So it's a very, very huge object. Today we know that it was part of a series of menhir, of huge menhirs, which were aligned here. We are in Loch Mariaquer near Karnak. Of course, Karnak is very well known for the alignments of stones, difficult to be dated. There are hundreds of stones aligned in rows, and there are many of such alignments of rows in Karnak. Another place which is certainly to be mentioned is Iberia. In Iberia, we find many, they call it dolmens, but actually they are more complex than dolmens. They are megalithic graves made up of stone corridors and covered. This is perhaps a masterpiece of the Iberian dolmen, is the Menga dolmen in Antequera. We shall visit it later on in this talk. And also in Iberia, we find stone circles. They are very old as well. And this is Almendras, for instance, in Portugal. So just to give you some idea of these places, when we arrive towards the Bronze Age, so let's say from the first millennium to the half of the second millennium, more or less, then we have the spectacular landscape of the so-called heart of the Neolithic Orkneys, which contains a series of monuments. This is the broadcast circle of stones, but there are many others in the Orkneys. Of course, Stonehenge. So I will not speak about Stonehenge now. We have quite relevant experts which will speak about Stonehenge, but just to remind you that the main megalithic phases of Stonehenge are in the 5th millennium BC. And of course, the world famous Newgrange tomb in Ireland, which also is dated to the 3rd millennium. And finally, in the Mediterranean area, we have the Malta temples. The megalithic phase of the Malta temples is up to the end of the 3rd millennium BC. And we have Italy. In Italy, we have many cases. Also unexpected cases, for instance, in Aosta, for instance, in Val Camonica, and so on. And in Sardinia, the one I'm showing here is in Sardinia because it is Monte Barante in Sardinia, because I'm going to speak about it. We worked about it recently, so it's an example I will show you. Okay, so the wall of Europe is plenty of such things. We have maybe thousands of stone circles, thousands of graves, hundreds of thousands of stones aligned in Karnak, and so on. All these monuments are, of course, silent. There is no written source telling us anything about them. Most of them are silent also from the archaeological point of view, as they have been looted, they have been frequented in many ways later on, so the stratigraphic findings are rare. There are indeed, but are quite rare. So what to do with such monuments? Understanding silent monuments is not an easy task. So I can say, provocative, I can say the tombs like Newgrange, this is my soul in the Orkneys, are at least tombs. So we do know that they were used for burials, at least. But even in this case, tombs are usually only elements in quite complex landscapes. So to say, oh, this is a tomb, okay, it helps, but it's not the end of the story. So, for instance, this is the Orkney landscape. It's very complex. It's very complex both from the point of view of the monuments. There are stone circles, these tennis, stone circles, there are graves, but also from the point of view of the horizon, of the landscape, that one is another island which makes a very special horizon for the massive tombs and the stones. And when we go to, for instance, stone circles, we find them scattered in the landscape, and even the Karnak stones, such a feeling of these objects which are so far from us. You visit Karnak and you walk kilometers around hundreds of stones without the stones telling you anything about the reason they were erected, were quarried and erected. So what to do? In the early 70s, thanks especially to the works of Gerard Hawkins at Stonehenge and Alexander Thom in Brittany, there was an idea set about that the main, if not the unique reason for the construction of all such huge monuments was the precise study of astronomical cycles through astronomical alignments. Usually these alignments are easy to understand. They are even the direction of rows of stones or direction which are pointed out at the horizon by particular features of the horizon foresight. This idea was the birth of arc astronomy. Today we do know that this is not the key, this is not the correct idea, but it was a way of it was an important starting point for a new science. So I just show you the, I will not comment, but just show you the very famous diagram of the Stonehenge alignment. Stonehenge as a Neolithic computer, Hawkins was calling it a Neolithic computer, aimed to predict eclipses, to predict movements of the moon, and so on. And about Alexander Thom, another famous diagram, he tried to interpret the Grand Menhir as a foresight for a very complex lunar observatory with very scattered places of observation at Eurides. There was a big problem here. Of course, Clive is much more expert than me about all this, so he can add something later. But there was a big problem. The problem was the selection problem of the alignments, but also the connection with archaeology. What was lacking was the connection with history and with archaeological data. So, for instance, the Thom's alignments are referred to places which are not contemporary. It refers to places which can be 1,000 years of distance in time. So, no sense at all in these cases. But in this way, anyway, a new science was going to appear. This science is archaeastronomy, and I think we can reasonably speak about the scientific method in archaeastronomy today. Of course, it is impossible to be to give any talk about any argument without showing the Giza aerophany, because I worked at Giza for 10 years, so I'm showing the Giza pyramids here, but it is impossible for me not to do that. The only connection is that it is broadly contemporary to Stone Age, 2500 BC. So let's say something about the scientific method in archaeastronomy. So it is, we can think to it as two parallel way of thinking. On the left, we have hard science. hard science progresses, of course, so today we do have a series of tools, high precision survey techniques, for instance, laser scanner, and all the techniques we are going to speak to hear and speak today later on. A series of very powerful techniques, which allow us to acquire data in with the rigor, scientific rigor, and the great quantity of data. We do have computers, so computer reconstruction of ancient sky and landscape, it is done in a very simple and very effective way today. Already my students in the archaeoastronomic arts are acquainted to use Google Earth and to merge images of Google Earth inside a computer planetarium to get a feeling of what was the ancient landscape and what is connection with the sky in ancient times. And of course we have standard mathematical tools, statistics when you have a lot of data, and data analysis. But on the same footing, on the same ground, we have archaeological data, we have historical sources. When it is possible, we have ethnoastronomy, it means people living today which still have traditions of astronomy which are coming from the ancient past. For instance, the Tzolk'in calendar of the Mayas is already in use, is still in use in some areas of rural Mexico, for instance. So all the kind of sources which can contribute to the archaeological historical part, and landscape archaeology, of course. All of this together can give us the context for the astronomical alignments. Astronomical alignments in context means making archaeoastronomy, really, and this can give us, it actually gives us a powerful tool for the interpretation of ancient architecture, as I will try to show you, but also a powerful tool for the promotion of cultural heritage. Think, for instance, to the attraction that a place can have to the general public, on the general public, if there is an appointment which was fixed by the builders, say, 4,000 years ago, 4,500 years ago, like the one you are looking here. This is the summer solstice at Giza. And a place like this, together with a hierophany, plan an event occurring each year, can have a great attraction and can help us in enhancing the cultural heritage. This also for Italy. In Italy, we do have a little bit of cultural heritage indeed, and we do need to enhance it. And there are many places in Italy where this procedure can be set up. Just to make an example, the city of Aosta, which was founded by Roman legion in honor of Augustus around 20 BC, 20 year BC, is oriented to the winter solstice sunrise. Each year we organize an event in Aosta with people coming to see the sunrise from below the mountains of Aosta in alignment. Still today is very perfect, it is perfect, in alignment with the axis of the Roman urban layout of Aosta. So we can use archaeoastronomy if use it in the correct way. Of course, if you had the Druids, Druids have nothing to do with Stonehenge, I mean, but modern Druids claim that they have to do with Stonehenge, and they are white dressed and go to the summer solstice at Stonehenge. So this is not the correct way of promotion of cultural heritage through archaeoastronomy, but there may be a correct way. Of course, one important initiative is the one which is held by Professor Ruggles with UNESCO and Astronomical Heritage, and so on. So let us see an example of arc astronomy in action. A very famous example is the New Grange tumulus in Ireland. It was built, say, 3000 BC, and it is megalithic in the sense that the slabs inside are megalithic. Then it was covered by this cardioid shape. It has a very clear symmetry axis. This is the axis of the dromos leading to the burial chambers. And we, here we see a section of the tumulus, and it is easy to check that it is pointing to the winter solstice sunrise. However, the winter solstice sunrise do not reach the chamber. If you make a virtual simulation of the light rays entering the chamber, you see that the steep of the corridor makes stops the rays before the chamber. So strange. But indeed, now since the end of the 60s, we know that the rays can enter from a window, a small window, which is called the roof box, which is over the entrance. So the rays can come in from the roof box, and we can still enjoy today the views of the sunrise entering the chamber. And as far as the previous point on the dissemination of cultural heritage is concerned, we can, everyone visiting New Grange can actually see it, because there is a artificial light illumination that reproduce the phenomenon. Okay, this is New Grange, but it is not enough. In a sense, it is just the beginning, because we can be rather convinced that it was an intended alignment. It is difficult to think that all of this occurs by chance. But New Grange is not isolated. Most of these monuments are not isolated. New Grange is a part of a very complex landscape. This landscape is the bend of the Boyne. The Boyne is the river which makes a turn, a bend. And nobody knows why, because it doesn't look as a special geomorphological reason. It is the river that just makes a bend. And the bend of the Boyne, which is completed to the north by another river, the Mato River, forms a sort of island. So the idea is that the whole landscape was an island of the dead. It contains two other main tumuli, the Note and the Dote chambers, and a series of other monuments and smaller chambers. So analyzing New Grange analyzing the orientation of New Grange is only the starting point. There are a series of problems which are actually in a part still open. Was it an island of the dead? Was it a pilgrimage center? We do know that the stones of New Grange were brought there from different places of scattered around the country. So perhaps it was a pilgrimage center. Which is the orientation of the other tombs, for instance, Note and Dote, and what is the role and the meaning of the abstract art? I think you know that the megalithic chambers, not only here but also in Gavrinis, for instance, in France, are covered by a sort of abstract art, a very complex art made up of spirals and other geometric engravings. The meaning is probably referring to a shamanistic version of religion, but we cannot be sure about that. So you see that from theory of all that was at the birth of arc astronomy, the monuments were made for astronomical observation. We are going to a very complex, but I think much more interesting, global view of the problems. And I would like to show you this example because precisely because we are going to a global approach to the problem, we can use arc astronomy also in the case where astronomy is not there. We are here in Iberia. There are many, maybe hundreds of Iberian dolmens, tombs. And due to the work essentially by Michael Hosking, we know that vast majority of them is oriented to the sun, rising or climbing in the sky. So there is astronomical orientation of the Iberian dolmens. But the cathedral of megalithic art, the most important one because it is the hugest one, the slab covering the tomb is 150 tons. Is the Menga Dolmen. The Menga Dolmen, here we see the entrance, you see how huge are these stones, and this is the inside. Inside is a large dromos with a chamber. It's not oriented astronomically. The azimuth of this chamber is too small even for the moon. So it is to the so close to the north that it's impossible for the moon and for the sun to shine directly in alignment with the chamber, contrary to the vast majority of the other monuments of the area. But when you visit it, you see that it was placed in a very special position with respect to the landscape. Here we are inside the Menga Dolmen looking out. So, precisely in the attitude of an archaeastronomer studying the possible alignment of this place. But we are not looking at the sky or at phenomena, celestial phenomena at the horizon. We are looking at a mountain. But this mountain is a very special one. It is the so-called Peña de los Enamorados. I don't know if the pronunciation is correct. But it's a very special one. You cannot mistake it for any other mountain elsewhere because it is just the profile of a human figure, recumbent human figure. There is no doubt about it. When you arrive in the Antequera Valley, you see it, immediately you think to a recumbent person. So, the horizon is occupied by this very special mountain, and Michael Hosking proposed that indeed this place was orientated to the mountain, which was in some sense that we don't know it was sacred. Interesting enough, today we do know that the mountain was frequented in the Neolithic. There are clear evidences of frequentation of the mountain in the Neolithic. There are even menhirs on the mountain. So this is the complexion of the reasonment, which comes again from the archaeological and historical part. We have the data. In this case, it's just one datum. That it is just the azimuth of the tomb and the fact that this clearly not oriented to the sun or to the moon. Difficult to say if there is an alignment to the stars, because I think you know that precession changes the content at the horizon of the star rising. So if you don't have a precise dating of a dolmen, you can say nothing about the possibility of orientation to a star. But let's say that we exclude that. And we do have a target. This target is a topographical one, but the method which is used to study it is the method typical of archaeastronomy. So to finish this talk, the end part of this talk is a place which is located in Italy, which we have studied here in collaboration with the geodesy laboratory of the Como branch of the Politecnico, and it is called Monte Baranta. It is in northwest Sardinia, very easy to reach from the main road which crosses the island. So it is a visit which I advise you to all of you to make this visit to all of you. The Monte Baranta hill is very well dated to Monte Carlo phase, which means end of Neolithic, starting of early Bronze Age in Sardinia, again contemporary to the Megalithic phase of Stone Age. We are from 2600 to 2200 BC. What is interesting enough, there are many things which are interesting about Monte Baranta, but perhaps the most interesting one is that it is just a building site. It was abandoned. They were working, one day they were working, they were erecting menhirs, I will show you. And the day after they decided, okay, let's go away. So it was left at an unfinished state and was never inhabited again. So it is a wonderful experience to visit. For, of course, for a general public, it can be not so exciting to visit a dock, a building site. But for a person interested in the way they were working, the way they were thinking, visiting a building site, a megalithic building site, is a wonderful experience. There is another one which you can do in Egypt, because the pyramid of the first son of Khufu was left unfinished on the Abu Ash Hill. So it's a dock, again, of a pyramid of the four dynasties. Again, it's a very interesting experience. So let's have a look to Monte Baranta. It is a hill, and the elements of the hill are the following. There is the so-called tower enclosure. The tower enclosure is a wall, a megalithic wall, which encircles a very small area. This area was, it is not smaller than it was in ancient time, because it is just the border of the rock which is on the hill. So we are sure that they built this huge wall, it's several meters thick, to enclose a small area of some tens of square meters, nothing more. The other element, so this is the tower enclosure. You see, it is made up of very huge blocks. This is when you see it when ascending to the hill. I will come back in a minute on that. And there are two entrances, very strange. You pick up the top of the hill, you enclose it with a wall with two entrances. And this is the inside. You see, you are inside, you are looking at the valley, you must be careful because you can go down. And the other element is a huge polygonal wall. The huge polygonal wall crosses the summit of the hill. But it is disconnected from the tower. So you cannot exchange people if you are under attack. Either you stay inside the tower or you stay inside the polygonal wall. They are not connected. Again, the area is very small, covered by the wall. And the wall is very low. It's less than 3 meters, and we do know that it was the original, in many points it was the original height, so it's very low, very imposing but very low. Outside the wall, there is the so-called, this is the thickness of the wall, outside the wall there is a so-called sacred area, which contains a stone circle, which was left at the stage, the final stages of construction. It is outside the wall. So this is the stone circle. The stones are very huge, and they were planning to erect them, so you can find the sockets of the stones on the ground. In particular, they wanted to erect this huge menhir. The menhir was carved into the granite. It is perfectly carved. It is ready to go. And when you look at the basis of the menhir, you can see it is not clearly visible because there is the shadow, but you can see that they engraved the socket. So the socket has been sketched on the bedrock, but was not excavated the day after they left. Nobody knows why. We have studied the stone circle in Monte Baranta. We have made some computer simulation because it is unfinished. In principle, it was probably open to the wind, to the summer solstice, sunset, but this kind of conclusion is doubtful because it is not complete. So indeed, it is not the astronomy at Monte Baranta that I wanted to show you. What I wanted to show you is that we started studying this place with a standard archaeological interpretation of these sites as fortresses. So Monte Baranta was a stronghold, according, for instance, to Lilio, which is the father of neuralgic archaeology. It was a stronghold. And when somebody asked him, but why the sacred area was outside the wall, he answered, certainly the enemies were respecting the sacred area, which can be an answer. But we were not convinced by this answer because a series of reasons. The wall is very low, the tower is disconnected from the wall, it has two entrances. Why it has two entrances? And the sacred area is outside the wall. So we applied again our landscape view, global landscape, try to apply global landscape view to Monte Baranta, and it is actually easy to see that the situation is quite more complex than a stronghold than Monte Baranta, because you can go up only from the from this direction on the hill, which is actually the also the modern access to the archaeological site. You go up from Olmedo, and this is the only way of going up today, as well as 4,000 years ago, because there is the steep hill on the other side. When you go up, you can't see anything, because when you reach the summit of the hill, you will see the polygonal wall, which is cutting the horizon, and the tower enclosure. So you go, you arrive at the top of the hill, and you see only man, human-built features. But if you can, if you are allowed to enter the tower enclosure, then you have a direct view of a very imposing hill. This very imposing hill, the Santo Pedro Hill, which is here. I should have another, yes. This is seen from the Santo Pedro Hill with Monte Baranta in the background. The Santo Pedro Hill was a necropolis. It was sacred since the Neolithic times. It is plenty of hypogea, of excavated tombs in the flank of the hill. There is neuralgic and pre-neuralgic activity on the summit of the hill. So we tentatively tried to interpret this place in a completely different way. It was a pilgrimage center, a sacred center dedicated to the living. I think today we shall hear something about a place which was where there was a place connected to the living and another place connected to the dead. I think we shall hear about that. And we tried a similar approach to Monte Baranta. It was a place of pilgrimage where people was allowed to have a view to the sacred hill. That's why it has two entrances. It has one entrance and one exit. So you see, it is quite, if you want, speculative approach. But after we published this work, we discovered that actually a very similar situation is occurring in Portugal. In Portugal, there are many late Neolithic, early Bronze Age places, which were all interpreted as strongholds, and now they are all reinterpreted as sacred places. So this is quite encouraging for also for this work. Okay, this is my last slide. The last slide contains a picture of a sunrise in alignment with a Malta temple, just to give a sort of hope of future development research in this field. Which are the conclusion and perspectives? So we have seen that we do have new powerful techniques of surveying and non-invasive prospection. We shall learn about in all this morning. But this has to go together with the approach to the landscape, to the ancient, to the today's landscape, but interpreted as the ancient landscape, which is cognitive, which that means that you try to understand the way the landscape was perceived by the ancients. So in this way, we can try to reconstruct the relationship of our ancestor with the landscape and the sky. And in this way, we can this can lead to a better understanding of ancient minds. Also, the dissemination of this approach is very important. And I indeed conclude with the fact that, as many of you can hear, we are aware from the newspapers that a Maya town has been discovered by using the Maya constellations in the sky. These newspapers knew made the whole world turn around. You can find it in any newspaper, in any website. But, unfortunately, we do not know the Maya constellations, because the constellations, the view of the sky of the ancients, was different from ours. By the way, our constellations are coming from the Greeks, from the Babylonian astronomy. The Mayas had no reason to have the same constellations as ours. Indeed, they have 13 constellations already in the ecliptic. And we do not know precisely which stars belong to which of the Maya constellations. So it is what is called, let me use an Italian word, it is called a bufala. So maybe that our global approach can help us. Bufala means a special kind of mozzarella, which is very good, by the way, so we can try it. This evening we can try it. The kind of bufala we can try. And so let's hope to avoid much more bufalas in the future. Thank you very much.